The Lost Barkscrolls by Paul Stewart and Chris Riddell. Read by Alex Jennings. The young apprentice librarian hurried up the steps of the great library. He crossed beneath the imposing statue of the first high librarian, Fembrus Lodd, and entered the vast circular building. Looking up, he saw the Barkscrolls hanging in great clusters. Countless precious manuscripts, meticulously transcribed in wood ink onto bark parchment and carefully stored by generations of librarians, stretching back to the time of Kobold the Wise, stored in the great library of the Free Glades. First-hand accounts of sky battles from the first age of flight hung next to works on every aspect of the Edgelands and its history, from the destruction of Old Undertown to the war for the Free Glades. The librarian stopped before one of the great pillars and began to climb. He was eager to find the treatise on sweetwood timber, which he needed to complete the study on buoyant wood. High up in the rafters, he eased himself down into one of the hanging baskets and, seizing a rope, pulled himself through the air. Sapwood, shankwood, stinkwood, he read off the plaques overhead. Sweetwood. He reached across and pulled towards him the dusty scroll holder that hung from a hook beneath the plaque. But inside the carved wooden tube, instead of Arboris Helquix's recent study of sweetwood, there were four dusty, long-forgotten bark scrolls. The librarian held them up. The margins of the scrolls were covered in intricate illuminations of ancient skyships, hooded stone pilots, strange goblins and great battles. Slowly he unfurled the first of the yellowing scrolls and began to read. The first bark scroll, Cloud Wolf.
"Prepare for descent, Ramrock," Wind Jackal called to his stone pilot. "We're going down."
"Aye, aye, Captain,"
Ramrock shouted back. Clad in a thick hooded coat and heavy boots, he worked to raise the temperature of the rock. The torches flared as he pulled the heating lever, and as the rock within began to glow, so the gale rider began to descend. Quint looked over the balustrade of the sky pirate ship and shuddered. Was his father mad, going down there into the Edgelands? Situated between the Deepwoods and the abyss beyond the Edge, the Edgelands was an inhospitable rocky wasteland, swirling with mists, where spirit shrieked and the gloam glozer was said to dwell. Quint crossed to the helm.
"I thought we were heading for Sanctifrax," said Quint. "You told me the Most High Academe had requested an audience."
"He has," said Windjackal. "But something else has come up, something far too big to be ignored."
"Father?" said Quint.
"A carrier ratbird arrived last night bearing a message from Ice Fox. A sky pirate assembly has been called for this evening, away from prying eyes, here at Wilderness Lair. And I don't have to tell you how unusual that is, Quint. Sky willing, we'll complete our business and be back in Sanctifrax in time to keep our appointment," said Windjackal. "And if we are not, well, Linnaeus Palatax and I go back a long way. And what is half a day between old friends?"
Quint shrugged and returned to the balustrade. Through the sulphurous mist was the tall mast of another great sky pirate ship slicing through the gloom.
"We're not the first,"
Quint shouted to his father.
"Nor shall we be the last," Windjackal replied. "A great pirate armada is gathering. It can mean only one thing."
"What?"
Quint asked.
"A sky battle," his father replied simply.
Slowly, Windjackal brought the skyship round and headed back towards the cliff face. Beneath the overhang, Quint saw a dozen or more sky pirate ships clinging to the sheer rock.
"Fire the fasting spikes!" Windjackal bellowed.
A volley of metal shot through the air. The sky pirates tugged at the ropes and secured them tightly. The gale rider came to rest alongside the other skyships. Together they clung to the vertical cliff face like a cluster of rock limpets.
"Look!" Quint shouted. "It's the fog scythe and the mismarcher."
He turned the other way.
"And there's the windspinner."
"And look!" said Windjackal.
nodding towards a two-mast vessel with a great brass harpoon at its prow.
It's the Cloudbreaker. Ice Fox himself must already be here.
The moment the Gale Rider moored, sky pirates from the adjacent ships lowered gangplanks and rope bridges, both to connect the fleet and to allow access one with the other. Old friends greeted one another warmly. Queep, the quartermaster, discovered that a long-lost cousin had become the Mistmarcher's head cook, while Steg Jambles, a bluff, bearded character, went off in search of his old flathead sparring partner, Hogmut, who had been crewing on board the Fogside the last time he'd heard from him. Quint, too, would have liked to explore the other ships, but Windjackal was adamant.
"You're to remain here, where I can keep an eye on you," he said.
All at once, a loud, mechanical voice filled the air. It was Ice Fox, standing in the caternest of the Cloudbreaker, a megaphone raised to his lips. A second individual was standing beside him.
"My friends," Ice Fox bellowed, 18 of you I summoned to Wilderness Lair. 18 sky pirate ships are here."
He paused.
"I have important news. Undertown is a free city with free citizens. It is written in the Constitution that no one is permitted to enslave another. Yet the leaguesmen flout this law. They press gang any they find to crew their ships and kill those who refuse."
There was a rumble of indignant murmuring.
"Who among us has not heard of the Great Sky Whale?"
The muttering grew louder. The Great Sky Whale, a vast four-mast league ship, was notorious throughout the Edge for the riches it transported and the barbaric treatment of its crew.
"This youth," Ice Fox continued, nodding to a gangly figure beside him, "who 3 days since managed to escape from the Great Sky Whale, can bear witness to the terrible conditions on board." "Blood-sucking leaguesmen," someone shouted. "Something should be done to teach them a lesson."
"Something will be done," Ice Fox broke in. "For the news I bring is that the Great Sky Whale is travelling from the Deepwoods to Undertown laden with jewels."
"But the ship travels with the entire Hammerhead Goblin Guard on board," a voice pointed out.
"And what about the armed escort fleet?" asked a third. 30 league ships there were at the last count."
Ice Fox raised his hands for quiet.
"I have information that for this trip the Great Sky Whale is travelling without an escort fleet and with only a single Hammerhead Guard company on board. Apparently the League's master, Marl Mancroyd, has commissioned the boat unbeknown to the other leaguesmen. He has just completed an illicit jewel deal with the Glinter Goblins of the Northern Mines, and the Great Sky Whale is carrying a small but priceless cargo of black diamonds. Mancroyd was hoping to feather his own nest without any other leaguesmen finding out. But with no escort fleet, we shall pluck the treasure out from under his nose, and we will free the captive crew. We will destroy the evil slave vessel once and for all." "Who is this youth that brings such unexpected tidings?"
Windjackal called across to Ice Fox.
"This is Penn,"
Ice Fox replied, and raised his arm high in the air.
"Former bootspit to the League's master himself. Now a free man once more."
"Penn. Penn," Windjackal murmured thoughtfully. The name was unfamiliar, yet the face of the gangly youth with the huge hands and feet was not. Where had he seen him before?
"We shall depart for the Deepwoods at daybreak," Ice Fox continued. "We shall use ratbirds to track the Great Sky Whale in the vastness of the Deepwoods. When they find it, we must strike as one."
He paused and looked around.
"And when we do, the treasure of the Great Sky Whale will be ours."
Quint barely slept a wink that night. As the first patches of light dusted the sky, he went up on deck.
"Quint," came Windjackal's surprised voice. "You're up early."
Quint turned to see his father in the misty shadows at the rear of the ship. Steg Jambles was with him. They were standing either side of a large cage, each holding a ratbird.
"I've taught them to seek and home," Steg Jambles explained. "They use sun angle and wind direction. Plus, they have an acute sense of smell. The scarf of that youth, Pen, has been cut up and distributed amongst all of us,"
he said, rubbing it round the ratbird's snout.
Its scent will guide the ratbirds to the great leadership.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.